How do we actually come up with our identification list for our metamorphic rocks? What we can actually do is kind of create a big table that helps us identify it. We're going to break it down and kind of look at texture and other features. And then come up finally with what the name of our sample is going to be. Okay. We're going to just start out by looking at things that are all foliated. So we'll just make two tables, we'll erase it halfway through so we can get an idea of what we're looking at. When we start at looking at foliated samples, we're first going to find fine grained samples. And then we're going to compare them. If we find some that are very fine-grained and they have what's called a slaty cleavage, the sample that we're going to have is going to be called a slate. Okay, so the question is, what in the world is slaty cleavage? When we look at this, this is going to be a sample that's very fine-grained. Okay, so we're talking about clay and silt-sized particles. It's going to be very dense, and it's going to have very distinct layers. Okay, and it's going to cleave into perfectly flat planes. Okay, the minerals that we're going to see making up this sample are generally clay minerals, which are very flat, planar, and they stack one on top of the other to create those nice planes. If you have a sample, you'll notice that they tend to be in different colors, so you can make the name modified with that color. It might be a black slate, a gray slate, a red slate, etc. Okay. The next fine-grained sample that we have often has a phyllitic cleavage. And then this is going to create the sample that's a phyllite. It kind of gives the name away. Okay, but the difference between a slate and a phyllite is just the particle size has gotten a little bit larger. We still see some clay minerals, but we're also going to see the growth of mica. The growth of the mica adds a little bit of a shine to this sample, so they tend to be a little bit shiny, but they're not sparkly, and it almost looks like they're greasy, kind of the sheen that we're looking at, or a slight gloss. Okay. And additionally, when we look at the layers, we tend to see wavy layers or laminations. Okay. Then we're going to get into our coarser samples, and we're going to just say coarse. It could be medium coarse or very coarse. The next group that we're going to look at is something that has schistosity. Okay, so it's schistose foliation is going to be associated with a schist. Okay. At this point, we've gone down. We've been metamorphosing this rock a little bit more. The minerals tend to be much larger. We're going to see lots of mica is going to be common, but other minerals can grow as well. We can see hornblende. We can see granite. It just depends on what was present in that rock before it was metamorphosed. We are going to see the layers continuing to develop, so it is foliated. The layers will become more flattened than they were in the phyllite, but they're not going to be as flat as they were in that slate. Okay, but the particle size is now large enough, it's over 1 millimeter in diameter, that we can see individual grains. And because we have all that mica, these tend to be very sparkly. The next one that we're going to look at has gneissic banding. Okay, and what that means is that we now have alternating bands of light and dark minerals. We often call this zebra striping. So what happens is that we've undergone so much metamorphism that the dark minerals and the light minerals start to segregate into bands, so we start to see a striped rock. It's black and white, or dark and white, in that color. And then the rock that we're going to see is called a gneiss. So it has a very funny spelling. It is pronounced nice, so it sounds like N-I-C-E. Okay, so that would be all of the foliated metamorphic rocks. These are all going to be non-foliated. So the texture category is not going to change. Non-foliated rocks can be fine-grained to coarse-grained. And what we're really going to do is focus on the other features. And this is really going to start to include the minerals. Okay. If we have a sample that is made out of calcite, remember, it's a mineral that's made out of calcium, Ca, and then carbonate, which has a carbon and three oxygens, so CaCO3. The rock that we're going to get is called a marble. Okay, just remember that calcite is very light in color. It's usually a little translucent. It can be white, and the resulting marbles, we can see a marble that is white, gray, pink, all of those little color variations are just a little bit of changes in some of the chemistry inside of that sample. They are very soft, so you can scratch this with a nail, not your fingernails, but a regular nail, and it would dissolve if you had a drop of hydrochloric acid to put on top of it. Okay. Marble often looks like quartzite. Okay, so the trick with quartzite is that it's made out of quartz. And we get quartzite by taking a very clean quartz sandstone and we're going to metamorphose it. And when we do that, the quartz sand grains are going to grow and they become interlocking. Okay. The quartz in a quartzite tends to look sugary or sandblasted. Okay, or more like frosted glass when you look at it. And because it's made out of quartz, which has a hardness of 7, you could scratch it with on a plane of glass, and you'll leave a streak on that glass plate. The next thing that we can start to look at would be anthracite coal. Okay. Anthracite coal is created by taking peat or bituminous coal, both of which are sedimentary rocks, and then we start to heat them up to a high enough temperature and pressure that it actually becomes much more denser. Anthracite coal tends to have conchoidal fracturing. It's going to have a higher density than bituminous coal, and though you may still see some of the layering that existed inside of the bituminous coal beforehand, it's going to break along conchoidal fractures instead of breaking along those planes. So that's a big difference. It's just been cooked a little bit longer. Okay. Another non-foliated metamorphic rock that you might encounter is Cornfeld. Cornfeld is going to be very dark in color. It can sometimes be a light purple or pink color. And it's created by taking basalts. Okay, so something that has a lot of minerals that are heavy in iron and magnesium. So think about things with augite in them. Okay, maybe something that has some hornblende. Okay, and we're going to start to metamorphose it. Hornfels tend to be pretty fine grains. So we very rarely see the individual grains, but they are going to be dark in color. Because of the high iron and magnesium. Okay, and unlike anthracite coal, which can be shiny, it's not going to have that conchoidal fracturing. Okay, so that's kind of a quick introduction to some rock identification for metamorphic rocks and how they came to be that way.